Good morning. I'm Pastor Ken Fisher. I am the president of Wisconsin Lutheran High School. It's a privilege to be able to lead you in worship today. As president of the high school, I don't teach a class. I work with our congregations and our supporters. I help with recruitment and overseeing some of our finances and other areas of our school. So you won't see me in class. You might see me on the civil rights tour. I have a privilege of leading that each year. But it is a blessing to be able to lead chapel and to see all your faces gathered to worship in the name of the triune God. So let's begin our worship. In the name of the triune God, the Father who created the heavens and the earth, the Son who redeemed the world, and of the Holy Spirit who sanctifies the faithful. Amen. Imagine the scene. A 68-pound freshman arrives at school. He's not really even 5 foot, maybe standing on his tippy toes. And he wants to play football, but football camp was at the beginning of, you know, the month of August, and now this is later. School is starting. He missed football camp, but you can still go out for the team. So he goes to the locker room after school, and a student manager and the JV coach try to fit him with the leftovers of what they have. Okay, they put some shoulder pads on him. They don't have any small enough for his shoulders. They really don't fit. A helmet, a little loose, but at least a helmet. They put on some pants. He has to cinch them up really tight, and they kind of all wad up because they're way too big. The thigh pads are really more like knee pads, and the knee pads are somewhat down the calf. Well, practice is about half over by the point that this is done, and they send him out. The varsity coach sees him coming out. I mean, again, not very big kid, 68 pounds. And he sends him, because he doesn't know where he's going. The team has already coalesced. They kind of know what's going on. He has no idea. And the varsity coach looks at him and says, "Go over there." Okay, he runs over there. And there, a coach is on a sled, and a group of linemen have lined up and are running into that sled with their shoulders and pushing the coach riding that sled. "Get in line," the coach says to him. Okay, and the little kid gets in line and takes his turn. Sled doesn't move. And the technique that he has displayed, which a coach has never seen before, causes the coach to roll in laughter and the whole team, because these are seniors and juniors on varsity, linemen who have been bouncing up against that sled and pushing it across the field. And this little 68-pound freshman is no match for that sled. Well, by the end of practice, looks in the mirror, and that young boy kind of feels like maybe football would be better as a spectator sport than a participant. That's maybe okay. Maybe wrestling would be a little bit better, because at least you're in a weight class with someone close to your size. And so that's the last practice for football for him. Can you identify? You know, not everyone's going to be a lineman. Not everyone's going to be the star of the team. Can you identify maybe with what that 68-pound scrawny little boy felt like as a freshman? Because high school's kind of hard. There's a lot of things that you're trying to figure out as you look in the mirror about yourself, about who you are, about what you really are. Because, you know, it's easy when you don't look in the mirror to not see yourself. I mean, I have a mirror here I brought from home. I'll put it up. When you start looking in the mirror, you notice whether everything's proper and right. You start seeing yourself maybe as you are, or others see you in a way that you don't see yourself before that. And that can happen in high school. Suddenly, you're no longer the star basketball player. You got cut. Maybe you thought you were the smartest one in your class, but that was a class that was much smaller than the one now. And boy, you're sort of in the middle of the pack. And you see some of those zits that are forming. Oh my goodness, what do I do with that? I guess in some ways, you know, as president, I go out and meet with congregations. We're owned and operated by over 50 congregations. We have a lot of people who support us, and without their support, we couldn't be the high school we are. But sometimes when I do Bible class, I'll ask, "Do you think it's easier today to be a high school student than when you were a high school?" I'm talking to older adults. "Or is it harder, or is it about the same?" And when people really wrestle with that, most adults will tell me they think it's harder, and I believe that. Do you think social media helps you see yourself clearly in ways that are helpful? Do you think the world around you is kind of in the images it shows of what it is to be a man or to be a woman? And then you compare yourself, I don't know. It's hard. And that's why the mission and the ministry of Wisconsin Lutheran High School is so important. As maybe you don't feel like you fit. Because I'm going to ask you, what's your story? Maybe your story isn't that one, but you have your own. And I bet you it's seared inside your head as you look in the mirror of high school and start to see yourself and the story that's being written of your life. Because I guess there's a couple ways you can look in this mirror. You can look in it and you can see your sin and you can see your imperfections and you can see all the things you've done and it starts to really, like, affect you. It's not a question of whether you'll see it. It's a question of how you'll react to it. Or I guess there's another way you could look at it. You might look in the mirror and not see any imperfections. Like, whoa, I'm looking pretty good. Maybe you have a false sense of unrealistic expectations about who you are and what you have. Or a sense of pride. Or maybe even victimhood. Or Pharisaism, where you kind of go, well, at least I'm not as bad as someone else. See, it's not really a question of whether you're going to have some challenges. It's a question of how you're going to approach them. Because you can either deny the realities that you start to see in yourself, or you can confess them and find strength and hope. Because there's a story to tell today that I want to share with you of someone else who came to understand how to put it all in a proper perspective, how to see it in a way that is godly and that God wants you to see it. As you are asked what your story is, and as your story unfolds before you, and that's why high school is so exciting and also so challenging. The person that I want you to hear the story of is the story of the Apostle Paul. And he relates that in 1 Timothy. He says this, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service, even though I was a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man. I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. Maybe you remember the story of Paul. He was a model student. He was a great kid, a kid that everyone would have looked up to and said, man, what a great young man. He seemed to have it all. And yet he was misguided because he found his strength in himself. He became a Pharisee. He looked down on everyone else. And then he persecuted the church of Jesus Christ. He didn't think he needed him. And yet God knocked him off his high horse. And he brought him to faith. So Paul continues describing that in this way. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus, might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen, Paul says. You know, I like what Ruth Graham once said she wanted as an epitaph on her tombstone, you know, the statement on her tombstone. She wanted, end of construction zone, thanks for your patience. Because she was seeing that her life was something of a project and that it was a construction zone in which God was at work. That's the way Paul looks at his life. Because this is really a story of God working in his life. It's a story of sin and recovery, of confession and forgiveness, of weakness and strength, of the mundane and the miraculous, of faith and answered prayer, of Jesus and what he means for us, and of a life fulfilled now and a life forever in heaven. To try to unravel Paul's story, I guess I want you to look at these aspects of Paul's story. There's a who, a what, a where, and a when. First of all, when you look at Paul's story as he just described his life and the story that was unfolding for him at the end of his life, even as yours unfolds at the beginning of your life, do you know who the center character, the main character of his story is? Here's the interesting point. It's not Paul. He mentions himself 10 times, I, me, but actually 16 times he mentions Jesus Christ or uses a pronoun for him. The who of his story and the who that God wants in your story that's being written is Jesus. And the what is a gift. The what of your story is a gift. It's not a reward that's achieved by those who are skilled enough, discovered by those who are smart enough, or won by those who are strong enough. Paul described it in these ways. It was given me. See, he says, given me strength. He appointed me to his service. He says, I was shown mercy. Those are all the gifts that God has given. And so the responsibilities that you're going to have, some of them you pick up now, some you'll pick up later. The privileges of service are all opportunities. That's God's perspective. When you see the story that's your life as a gift of God, then you come to trust the one who gave it is generous and he's wise. So he gave you what you need, and maybe it's not to be a lineman, and he made you who you are, and so your life can then be a reflection of what you have in him rather than a chasing after yourself and a wondering whether you have enough smarts and strength and skills. No. Your life's a gift in him, so you can look at it in a different way. Well, where are all these blessings found in God? It's interesting. Paul says they're found in me. Where exactly does Paul find the blessings of God? In himself. You know, salvation and God is not out there somewhere to be found, like you're going to chase after him. He says he's in you. He's in you through your baptism. That triune God whom we called upon to come here today, as was described yesterday, we come to worship him because we believe he's at work in us. That's what makes Wisconsin Lutheran High School different. There's a lot of high schools you could go to, and you're going to struggle for the same things. But I'm praying that you keep finding in you, God wants to dwell. You're his workshop. He wants to put you on display as his trophy case to the world. And then finally, he says, when does all this happen? Well, he, at the end of it, he says, it's now, and it's to the honor and glory of God forever and ever. You see, the gifts that God wants to give you, the life that he wants to be fulfilled in you, is now. It starts now. That's why we come to this place each day, and we have to ask ourselves, do we see ourselves as sinners in need of God's help? And if we don't, if we can't come here feeling as if, I need this. I need God's forgiveness. I need to be honest with God about who I am. I need to look in the mirror and yet see his grace reflected in my life too. And that's why even though we don't confess and receive absolution, this public announcement of forgiveness every day in chapel, we often do. And we will in just a minute. Because that's how that fulfilled life continues to grow. You know, that 68-pound scrawny kid, his story wasn't done being written. I know, because it's my story. That was my story. And wrestling was a much better option for me. I qualified for state there, but football, it wasn't going to happen. And you know what? That's okay. And each of your stories as they're written are going to be different. But I'm praying that you see the main character of your story is Jesus, who wants to give you the gift of his grace, that's the forgiveness that are yours in him, so that in him, working in you, now and forevermore, you'll give him praise. Would you mind joining in confessing your sins and receiving that assurance of his forgiveness? Join with me. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. This is the message we have heard from him and have declared to you. If we claim to have fellowship with him, yet walk in darkness,
we lie and do not live by the truth.
If we claim to be without sin,
we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us.
Join with me in confessing then. Father, I have sinned against you and am no longer worthy to be called your child. Yet in mercy you sacrificed your sons to purge away my guilt. For his sake, O God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And in the joy of your Holy Spirit, let me serve you all my days. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Upon this, your confession, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to join in singing four stanzas of this hymn, Jesus Sinners Does Receive. The fourth stanza, I'm going to invite you in the little interlude between the stanza to stand and remain standing for prayer and the benediction. Teach us, O Lord, to delight in your law, to follow your decrees, and to walk in your paths. Turn our eyes away from worthless things and our hearts from willful sin, that we may know the sweetness of your word, the peace of your forgiveness, and the joy of the redeemed, both now and forever. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God the Father and from Jesus Christ, the Father's Son, who will be with us in truth and love. Amen. You are dismissed.